Good morning, class. So today we are going to continue the tutorial 2. Thanks to the topic 1.3, the stoichiometry, 2.3, sorry. We'll start, I'll give you the objective answer first. Okay, so number one, B-boy. Number two, B-boy. Number three, D-donkey. Number four, A. Number five, C. Okay, number five, C. Number six, B-boy. Seven, C. Number 8A, number 9 B-boy, 10 C. Okay, question 11 will be the subjective. So from question 1 to question 10, any question? Question 4, question 6, okay. Question 4, 6, 10. Okay, let us look at the question 4 first. Okay. 1 gram, okay, 1.00 gram of carbon is combusted in a limited supply of pure oxygen. Okay, then they told you 0.5 of the carbon. So half of the carbon, initially you have 1 gram, right? So half of the carbon becomes CO2, another half becomes CO. So CO2 and CO both passes through the NaOH, then the remaining gas is then dry. Okay, then what is the volume of the remaining gas? Okay, so let us, okay, this one, okay, first thing first, you need to write down the equation first, okay? Okay, write down the equations. So we have two different reactions here. The first one, carbon plus oxygen gas to form CO2, right? Okay, the second reaction is carbon plus oxygen gas to form CO. So in order to balance the second equation, so you need to halve the oxygen gas here. Okay, so these two are your product, right? Carbon dioxide and the carbon monoxide are your products. Okay, these two products, then they say these two gases pass through the NaOH. Okay, then carbon dioxide, only carbon dioxide will react with the NaOH. NaOH plus CO2 to form Na2CO3, okay, plus H2O. Na2, so two more here. Okay, so this will be the reaction. Only carbon dioxide will react with the NaOH. So what is the remaining gas? The remaining gas, it will be the carbon monoxide. Okay, it will be carbon monoxide. So carbon monoxide is then dry, then collected. So what is the volume of the remaining gas? So what? So the if you analyze the question in this way, so you will know that actually the question it is asking you what is the volume of the carbon monoxide at the RTP, right? 25 degrees Celsius and 1 atm at RTP condition. Okay, so in order to find the volume of the carbon monoxide, we need to calculate the mole first, right? So what is the mole of the carbon monoxide? We refer back to the this second equation. So the one mole of carbon monoxide is produced by one mole of carbon. Okay, one mole of carbon monoxide is produced by one mole of carbon. So the ratio here it is 1:1. So we can calculate. So the question here given the mass of the carbon, right? 0.50 gram of the carbon. Okay, which we are converted to carbon monoxide. So the number of mole of the carbon is equal to the number of mole of the carbon monoxide. So to get number of mole of the carbons, we take 0.50 divided by the relative atomic mass. Okay, so the mole here you get 0.0417 mole. Okay, when you get mole, can you find the volume? Yes, right. Okay, so the volume of the carbon monoxide, it will be 0.0417 multiply 24 dm cube. So your answer, it should be very close to 1. Yeah, your answer is 1 dm cube. Okay. Okay, so okay, question 10 already understand. Good. Now we look at the question 6. Okay, question 6. The shells of a chicken's egg made up by 5% of the mass of an average egg. Okay, so an average egg has a mass of 50 gram. Okay, so first thing we need to, okay, now they give you an egg. Okay, an egg. Then inside we want to find out what is the shell. Okay, eggshell. Eggshell is 5% mass, okay, of the egg. Okay, so here we assume all the eggshell is pure calcium carbonate. Okay, we assume that all these 5% of the mass are the calcium carbonate. So how many complete chicken eggshells would be needed to neutralize? Okay, neutralize the 50 centimeter cube of 2.0 mole per dm cube ethanoic acid. Okay, ethanoic acid, it is, okay, the formula is CH3COOH. Ethanoic acid is monoproteic acid, means one molecule can only release one H plus. Okay, this one you should learn in your secondary school, for the carboxylic acid. It can release the H plus. Okay, so H plus the carbonate. Okay, acid react with the carbonate. Okay, before that, let me remind you, okay, the acid, the main reactions acid, okay, the acid can carry out. The first reaction is acid plus base. Okay, you will get salt plus water. This is the neutralizations. Okay, the second one is acid plus active matter. Okay, generally we will just say matter. However, not all the matter will react with the acid. So acid plus matter, you will get salt plus hydrogen gas. Okay, number three, it will be acid plus carbonate. You will get salt plus water plus carbon dioxide. These three are the acid properties, okay, which you have learned in your secondary school. So this one you should already in your mind. Okay, so come to this question. Acid plus carbonate. So this is one of the neutralization reaction. Okay, acid plus carbonate, because carbonate is considered one of the base also. Okay, so acid plus carbonate. Okay, so here they ask you, you need to prepare how many egg cells, right? So from here, we need to find out what is the number of mole of the calcium carbonate required. Okay, we need to find out what is the number of mole of the calcium carbonate required. This will be the first step. Okay, so okay, now I write down the complete equation first. Calcium carbonate plus ethanoic acid CH3COOH to form salt. Okay, what is the salt? It will be the CH3COO minus, right? So minus, however, calcium is 2 plus, right? So you will have 2Ca. Okay, calcium is carried 2 positively charged. CH3COO minus only 1 negatively charged. So in order to balance, you need to have 2CH3COO minus plus your water and also CO2. Okay, then we need to balance it. So we need to have 2 mole of the ethanoic acid plus H2O plus CO2. Okay, then write down what are the informations provided. Okay, we have 50 centimeter cube of the ethanoic acid, 2.0 mole per dm cube of the ethanoic acid. So can we find out the number of mole of the ethanoic acid? Can, right? So the number of mole of the ethanoic acid, it will be mv over 1000. Okay, what is the concentration? 2.0 multiplied with the volume 50 divided by 1000. So your answer should be 0.10 mole. Okay, 0.10 mole. Then the number of mole of the calcium carbonate required. Okay, we continue. So it will be 1 to 2, right? So half 0.10. So you get 0.0050 mole. Okay, then this is the number of mole of calcium carbonate required. Okay, when we find out the number of mole of the calcium carbonate required, the second step, we calculate what is the mass of the calcium carbonate required. Okay, so when you have mole, how to calculate calcium carbonate? We multiply the relative formula mass, right? Okay, calcium, it will be 40.1 plus 12 plus 3 multiplied 16. Okay, so what will be your answer? Okay, so the mass required, it will be 5.005 gram. Okay, so this is the mass of the calcium carbonate. Then, now look back to the questions. How many, so this is the mass of the carbonate required. Then now, the next one, what is the mass of calcium carbonate in one eggshell? Okay, in one eggshell. So here, 5% mass, right? 5% of the mass of an average egg. So average egg has a mass of the 50 gram. So we take 5 divided by 100 multiplied by 50. Okay, 5% of the 50 gram. So the mass of calcium carbonate in one eggshell, you get 2.50 gram. Okay, so how many eggshells in order for you to get 5 gram? You need to multiply by 2, right? So your answer, it will be B-boy. Okay, you need 2 complete chicken eggshells to neutralize the 50 centimeter cube of 2.0 mole per dm cube of the ethanoic acid. Can? Okay, so question 10, okay. Okay, sodium hydrogen carbonate plus acid. Okay, question 10, you have hydrogen carbonate, NaHCO3. Plus the acid. Okay, the acid here, it will be H2SO4. So this is hydrogen carbonate. You can treat it like carbonate. So what do we have at our product? It will be salt, H2O plus CO2 also, okay? So the salt, it will be Na2SO4 plus CO2 plus H2O. Okay, balance it, 2 mole here. So 2 mole of the CO2, 2 mole of the H2O. And let me check it again. 6, 10, 4, 4, 8. 4, 4, 8 is okay, let us continue. Sorry for the my Wi-Fi not stable. Okay, Okay, let me write down the chemical equation again. Okay, so this would be your chemical equation. Hydrogen carbonate, it will be your washing powder. Okay, then the acid here, you use 7.15 centimeter cube of the H2SO4, the concentration 0.100 mole per dm cube. Okay, for the complete reaction, then what is the percentage of the mass of the sodium carbonate in the washing powder? Washing powder give you 1 gram. Okay, so hydrogen carbonate is only one of the ingredient in the washing powder. So this 1 gram, right, you cannot treat it all of the 1 gram here. It is hydrogen carbonate. Okay, only part of the washing powder is the hydrogen carbonate. It may have other ingredients. Okay, so now they want you to find out what is the mass percentage of the sodium hydrogen carbonate in the washing powder. So we can start our calculation from acid. Okay, since provided the volume and the concentration already, so first step, we can calculate the number of mole of the H2SO4, right? MV over 1000, 0.100 multiply 7.15 centimeter cube divided by 1000. So your mole it is 7.15 times 10 to the power of negative 4 mole. Okay, then the next step, we do stoichiometry. What is the number of mole of the sodium hydrogen carbonate? Okay, 1 mole of the acid to 2 mole of the carbonate, right? Hydrogen carbonate. So we need to multiply by 2. Okay, then this is the mole of the sodium hydrogen carbonate. Then we find the mass, because at the end we want to compare the mass percentage, right? So we take the mole multiply with the relative formula mass. So your answer, it should be 23 plus 1 plus 12 plus 3 16. Okay, then the mass here, it will be 0.12 gram. Okay, so from here, in one gram of the powder, you have 0.12 gram of the sodium hydrogen carbonate. So what is your mass percentage? Okay, your mass percentage, it is equal to 0.12 divided by 1 gram multiply 100%. So you get 12.0%. Answer would be C. Okay. Now let us look at the I remember questions 11 we have discussed. How about 12? Should be right. 13 also. Yeah, and then I think 14 we do it halfway, right? pathway. So I think we start from C. Okay, if I miss anything, you let me know, huh? Okay, so for 14C, sample A was vaporized. Okay, so up to B, you already calculate the empirical formula for the CH2O. Okay, then here, they give you the mass of the sample A and the volume occupied at the STP. Okay, volume occupied at the STP. So STP is standard temperature and pressure, right? So it based on the definition, it is one mole of the gas, it would occupy 22.4 dm³. Okay, then here the unit given is centimeter cube, right? So if we convert the dm³ to centimeter cube, it will be 22,400 centimeter cube. Okay, so we take 55.4, we divided by the 22400, so we get the mole. Okay, we get the mole of the A. When we have mole of the A and we have the mass, okay, then we can get, we can calculate the relative molecular mass of the sample A. So this would be your answer, 59.8. Okay, 59.8. Then using the relative molecular mass to find out what is the molecular formula. So this would be the general molecular formula. Okay, how we calculate from the empirical formula, we put the empirical formula in inside the bracket, then we put an N here. Okay, then now we want to find out what is the N. Okay, then the N, it cannot be decimal. Okay, the N cannot be negative value. It must be positive integer value. Okay, so throughout the calculations, then your N, okay, I think you should get something decimal. You round it off. It will become, the N will become 2. So your final answer for the molecular formula, it will be C2H4O2. Okay, C2H4O2. Okay, now 15. Okay, ammonia gas. We have 1.20 dm³ of the ammonia gas dissolved in the water to form 200 centimeter cube aqueous alkaline. Okay, at room temperature and pressure. So use data booklet to calculate how many number of mole of the NH3. Okay, then you can see here, they ask you calculate the gas, okay, G. So you have volume, you have the condition. So straight away, we can find out what is the number of mole, right? 1.2 divided by 24. Then your answer, 0.05 mole. Okay, then write the equations for the ammonia react with the H2SO4. So this will be your balanced chemical equations. It is 2 mole of the NH3 plus 1 mole of the H2SO4 to form ammonium sulfate. Okay, this is ammonium sulfate. In number 3, calculate the volume of 0.50 molar H2SO4 is required to neutralize 200 cm³ of the aqueous ammonia. Okay, for this question, right? You have two ways to do it. Okay, the first way is we use the formula. Okay. Do you still remember there is one formula to use for the titration? MAVA divided by MBVB equal to NA divided by NB. Okay, or M1V1 divided by M2V2 equal to N1 divided by N2. Okay, same thing. So, okay, they ask you to find out what is the volume of the acid, right? So let's say here, A, I treat it as acid, B, I treat it as base, okay, or alkaline in this case. So A, VA would be something we want to find out, volume of the acid, okay? So concentration of the acid provided, volume of the ammonia aqueous provided, okay, MV. Okay, never mind, we go to the NA and B first. What is the NA and the MB here? Okay, this is based on the balanced chemical equation. Okay, NH2 mole of the NH3 plus H2SO4 to form NH42SO4. Okay, so this would be your NB. This will be your NA. So NB, it will be 2 mole, NA, it will be 1. Okay, then let us substitute the value. MA, it will be 0.50. Okay, then VA. Okay, MB, VB, we remain it first. Equal to 1 over 2. Okay, 1 over 2. So, okay, then, now let us look at the MBVB. Okay, in questions, only provided you the volume of the ammonia solutions, right? They didn't give you the concentration of the equation, of the ammonia solutions. So basically, MB you do know. Okay, however, when M multiply B, okay, M, B, V, B. M multiply volume, what do you get? You get number of mole, right? Okay, so actually M, B, V, B, it is, if you consider these two terms together, it is referring to the number of mole of the NH3 in the solution. Okay, so in this case, you can substitute 0.05 directly. Okay, because at the 15 part one, you already calculate the number of mole of the NH3 gas, right? So in this case, MBVB, you can directly substitute 0.05 mole. Okay, so substitute 0.05 equal to half. One equation, one unknown, definitely you can solve it. So you will get the value 0.05. Then the unit here, it is dm cube. Okay, this is dm cube. Then, okay, you can fit, you can put this as your answer, or you want to convert it to centimeter cube also can. So your answer, it will be 50 centimeter cube. Okay, this is one of the way using the formula to do it. Okay, that is another way we use the stoichiometric coefficients method to do it also. Okay, it would be, okay, when you, if you use stoichiometry methods, then make sure you need to have a balanced chemical equation, okay? Okay, so at part one, you already get the mole of the NH3, it is 0.05 mole. Okay, then they give you the concentration for the sulfuric acid 0.5 mole per dm cube. Then what is the volume? Right, this is basically the question. Okay, so since you already get the number of mole of the 0.05 for the ammonia, so then we can calculate the number of mole of the H2SO4. So 2 to 1, right? 2 to 1. Here is 1. So 1/2 zero multiplied with the 0.05. So the number of the acid, it will be 0.025 mole. So when you get mole, then the concentrations and the volume. So MV/1000 equal to 0.025 mole. Concentration, you can substitute 0.5 O, then the volume of the acid required divided by 1000. Okay, then your volume, it would be 50 centimeter cube. Okay, if you're using MV/1000, then the final unit for the value, it is centimeter cube. If you just use MV equal to number of mole, then your volume, the unit, it will be dm cube. Okay. Okay, now let us move on to the next question. MBBB. Okay, it is very easy. You can you can treat it. Okay, the number of mole of the solutions, right, of anything in the solutions, it is MV/1000, right? This is the formula. Okay, so if to why we need to divide this 1000, it is because for the unit conversion, right? For the unit conversion from dm cube to it will be centimeter cube to dm cube. Centimeter cube to dm cube. Okay, then let's say today, if your volume is provided in dm cube already, so what would be your formula? Your number of mole equal to m multiply v without 1000. Why? Because your unit for the volume, it is in dm cube. So if today the number of mole you want to calculate is the alkaline ammonia today, so it will be MBBB. Okay, so actually concentration multiply volume, you will get number of mole. Can? Okay, actually there is another method for you to determine, because actually we can look at the unit. So if we take concentration multiplied by the volume, right? Okay, if the volume here, it is dm cube. So we look at the unit, concentration always mole per dm cube, right? Then we multiply something. If the volume here is dm cube, then we can cancel out the unit, right? Cancel out the unit, multiply together, what do you get? You get mole. Okay, this is the most simplest way to help us to determine what we are calculating. Okay, because sometimes in exam, right, it may give you some weird things or some weird units. Sometimes you do some multiplications, then you can you do multiplication or divisions for the units, then it can help you okay, it can help you to know, okay, or to understand what are you calculating, okay, what is the values or what is the units, okay, so to help you answer the question better. Okay, 16. What is the number of mole of the S2Cl2 present in 2.7 gram? So this one you just convert it, right? You take the mass, you divide it by the relative molecular mass here. So you get number of mole. Okay, then number two, what is the mole? Okay, what is the number of mole of the sulfur produced from 1 mole of S2Cl2? Okay, so from here, from the part one, okay, from the part one, we know that the 0.02 mole, okay, 2.7 gram of the S2Cl2 here. You look at this statement. 2.7 gram of the S2Cl2 means that it is 0.02 mole of the S2Cl2. We can get 0.96 gram of the sulfur. Okay, then what is the mole of the sulfur we get here? Okay. 0.96, you divide by the relative atomic mass, so we get 0.03 mole of the sulfur. Okay, so from this statement, we can see that 0.02 mole of the S2Cl2 react with the excess water, then we can get 0.03 mole of the sulfur. Then now question asks, what if your reactant S2Cl2 now become 1.0 mole? What is the number of mole of the sulfur now? Okay, so here you 0.02, if you want to convert it to become one, you just divide it by 0.02, right? So you can get one. So same thing here, you divide it by 0.02. So at the end, your answer, it will be 1.5 mole of the sulfur would be produced. Okay, question two, basically, they are asking stoichiometry. Then they ask you to convert. Now, what if 1 mole? Okay, so the way we to answer this question, we still look for the stoichiometric coefficient. Okay, 2 to 3. So if it is 1 now, so 1 to 1.5. Okay, then now let us construct the balance equation. Okay, to construct these equations right there is one technique. S2Cl2, right? S2Cl2 to and the sulfur. S2Cl2 react with the water, right, to form sulfur. So the ratio between these two, it must be 1 to 1.5 or 2 to 3. Okay, because from here, we already proved that the relationship is over here, the ratio. Okay, it's 1 to 1.5. It is 2 mole S2Cl2 now. How many mole for the sulfur? 3 mole. Okay, then using this, then you balance the equation, okay? So what are the side product? There are HCl and also sulfuric acid, H2SO3. Okay, H2SO3. Then basically if you add in these two, at your product side, then you balance it, then this would be your balance equation. Okay, 2 mole of the S2Cl2 plus 3 mole of the H2O to form 3 mole of the sulfur plus 4 mole of the HCl plus 1 mole of the H2SO3. Okay, now let us look at the next question, 17. Okay, titanium also react with the chlorine. When excess chlorine reacted with the titanium, so you will have 2.85 gram of the chloride. So calculate what is the titanium use. Okay, number of mole. You have mass. Okay, then you look for the relative atomic mass at your data booklet. So you divide it by the 47.9. So this will be the answer for the number of mole of titanium used, 0.015 mole. Okay, then calculate the number of mole of the chlorine atom reacted. Okay, so okay, let us write down the equation first. So here we have titanium plus chlorine gas to form chloride. Okay, chloride, what is the final answer? We don't know, but we know it's A. Okay, so we have 0.72 gram of the titanium is reacted completely. Okay, then we have chloride of the titanium. The mass, it is 2.85 gram. Okay, so from 0.72 gram to become 2.85 gram. So the increase in mass, it is due to the additions of the chlorine gas. Okay, I repeat one more time. The increase in mass means 2.85 you minus the 0.72. Okay, means that is an increase of mass of 2.13 gram, right? So this 2.13 gram come from where? It come from the chlorine gas. Okay, so means that from the mass difference, we can know that how much of the mass of the chlorine reacted. Okay, then we use this, okay, we use this mass to find out what is the chlorine atom. Okay, you highlight atoms. We want to find out one single atom, okay, not Cl2 molecule. So from the answer here, you can see that I'm using 35.5, not 71. Okay, because we want to find out chlorine atom. Okay, so we take the mass divided by relative atomic mass. So the mole, we get 0.06 mole. Okay, we have 2 mole here. Okay, so when it comes to number 3, can we determine the empirical formula of A? Definitely can, right? So we find out the simplest mole ratio, it is 1 to 4. So the empirical formula for the A, it will be TiCl4. Okay, then number 4, you just construct a balance equation between titanium and chlorine. So as long as you know what is the final formula, TiCl4, then you plus 2 mole of the Cl2 here. Okay, okay, question 18 is a bit challenging. Okay, A, it will be the definitions. What is meant by the term molecular formula? The actual number of atoms of each element present in one molecule of the compound. Okay, then B. Okay, B, sometimes they will ask you to use unknown to balance your, to balance the equation, especially the general hydrocarbon, CHHY. Okay, so you can select to memorize this, or you can actually balance by yourself also can. Okay, so how? Let me do it one time for you. Okay, CHHY, we assume that it undergo complete combustion, so for the final product it will be CO2 plus H2O, right? So first thing we balance the carbon. So we have X carbon here, so X mole of the CO2. Okay, we have HY here. Okay, but here the H is H2, right? So how to get Y? Y divided by 2, multiply 2, you get Y, right? So we put Y over 2 here. Okay, then how to balance oxygen gas? Okay, to balance oxygen gas, it will be X. Okay, this is 2X, right? Okay, X 2, so 2X here. So 2X divided by X. This one I write at the bottom first. Huh? So 2X divided by 2. Okay, 2X divided by 2 plus here. Okay, Y over 2 multiplied with the O, right? Okay. Y over 2. Okay, then don't forget here, it is O2. So we need to divide by 2 again. Okay, so finally, you will get, okay, 2 and 2 cancel out. So you get X plus Y multiply 1, or still Y, 2 multiply 2 divided by 4. So this will be your answer for the oxygen gas. In exam, of course, if you are good in multiplying with the all these unknowns, then sure, straight ahead. You can go ahead, you can do all the, you can balance it in exam, okay? If you do not have confidence, then I will encourage you to memorize the general form, okay? For the hydrocarbons combustion equation. Okay, then come to the questions. When you have 10 centimeter cube of A was mixed at room temperature with 50 centimeter cube of oxygen. So here they told you that the oxygen is in excess, okay? Exploded, okay, undergo combustion. So you have 40 centimeter cube gas remain after cooling the apparatus to RTP condition. So from here, we can assume that all the water vapor become liquid already. Okay. Then the second statement, when this 40 centimeter cube of gas was shaken with the excess KOH, so this is a strong alkaline. Strong alkaline, it will react with the CO2, right? Okay, it will react with the CO2. So 40 centimeter cube become 30 centimeter cube. So that is missing 10 centimeter cube, right? So from here, we can conclude that at the remaining gas here, we have 10 centimeter cube of CO2 gas. Okay, the missing gas, it will be CO2 gas. Okay, then what is the identity of the remaining 30 centimeter cube of the gas? It will be the remain oxygen gas. Okay, unreacted oxygen gas, since oxygen gas is in excess, right, before the experiment. So means that at the end of the experiment, it should have extra, or we say remaining oxygen gas. Okay, then number two, combustion A produce a gas that reacted with the KOH. What is the identity? CO2. Okay. Number three, what is the volume of the gas you have identified in two? It will be 10 centimeter cube. Okay, we take 40 multiply 30. Okay, then what is the oxygen gas used up for the combustion? So initially there are 50, right? Okay, then at the end there are only unburned 30, means the oxygen gas is consumed 20 centimeter cube. 20 centimeter cube of the oxygen gas is consumed. So this 20 centimeter cube is used to undergo combustion. Right. Okay. So the answer will be number four. Okay. Then D, use the equation in B and your result C and number three and number four, C3, C4. Okay, to calculate the molecular formula for the A. Okay, this one, we can use equations to help us since they ask you, right? They provide you the hints, so we follow the hints. So use the general equation. Okay, you write it down. Then I also encourage you write down what is the volume. Okay. From the volume, we can see how it reacts actually. Okay, so 10 centimeter cube, 20 centimeter cube of oxygen gas, I only shows the reacting oxygen gas, means how much of the oxygen gas is consumed. I write 20 only, not 15. Yeah. Then CO2, it will be 10 centimeter cube. Okay, water, I didn't write anything here because H2O already in liquid. Okay, liquid doesn't occupy the gases volume. Okay, so 10, 20, 10. So from here, it is 1 mole, 2 mole, 1 mole. Okay, 1 mole, 2 mole, 1 mole. So from here, the X is equal to 1. The X is equal to 1. From here, we can directly determine the stoichiometric coefficient. Okay, the X is equal to 1. Then if X equal to 1, then what is the Y value? Y we cannot determine from the water, okay, because we do not have any info. Okay, but we can determine from the oxygen gas, right? So if X equal to 1, so we substitute 1 into the X, then X plus Y over 4 equal to 2, because 2 mole here. Okay, 2 mole here. So one equation, only one unknown Y. So what is your Y? Y is equal to 4. So at the end, CXHY, right? So your C is 1, H is, Y is 4. So finally your formula, it will be CH4. Okay, although these questions, it seems like hard. Okay, but actually, if you can use, if you go through the question in this way, right, it is not, actually it's provide use the guidelines, if you notice. Okay, because actually B and C, right, the questions are very simple. And actually all these questions, right, they are prepared, used to answer the final questions. Okay, the final question D. Okay, so if actually they can ask D directly without asking you B and C. Okay, so nowadays the questions have this kind of trend. They ask you some things in advance, then they will ask you to use this answer to continue the, usually it is final questions. Okay, at the last part. So in these questions, the final answer or final question they want you to find out is the molecular formula of A. Then your answer would be CH4. Okay, then we have two more, right? 19 and 20. 19. Okay, this 19. Okay, define the mole. Okay, mole actually, there are a lot of the definition actually. Okay, but in our syllabus, right, we define moles in term of the mole, right, is actually referring to the any amounts, the amounts of the substance, okay, containing 6.02 times 10 to the power of 23 particles of the substance. Okay, we define it in term of the number of particles. Okay, this one, please remember. Okay, then next one. We go through the question first. We have a gaseous hydrocarbon CHHY react with the oxygen gas. Then the final volume of the gaseous mixture was 95. Okay, for this kind of the questions, we use the IF table. Okay, initial, final. So first thing, we write down the equation first. Wait, CHHY. Okay, we cannot plot the, we cannot tabulate the table because over here our hydrocarbon is unknown. Okay, so we go okay, goes through this sentence. This gaseous mixture was treated with the concentrated aqueous NaOH to absorb CO2. Then this reduced the gas volume from 95 to 75. So it means that there are 20 centimeter cube of the CO2 gas. Okay, 20 centimeter cube of the CO2 gas. Then, okay, first question, write down the equations between the reaction of the NaOH plus CO2. Okay, actually there are two equations are accepted. Okay, the first one is NaOH plus CO2, you get carbonate plus H2O. Okay, another equations is NaOH plus CO2, you get sodium hydrogen carbonate. Okay, without the water behind. Okay, two possible equation. Okay, then number two, calculate the volume of the CO2 produced by the combustion. So this one we already go through the statement just now. So there is 20 centimeter cube of the CO2 gas. Okay, then number three, calculate the volume of the oxygen used up. So the remaining 75, obviously they are the unburned oxygen gas. So initially there is 100 oxygen gas, right? So 100 minus 25. So the consumed oxygen gas, it will be 25 centimeter cube. Okay, 25 centimeter cube. So now use the question, use the answers B2 and B3 to help you to balance the hydrocarbons below. Okay, so since here it from what you have get, right? So CO2 with the oxygen gas, the relationship, it is 20 centimeter cube to 25 centimeter cube, right? Okay, so if we convert to mole, it will be 20, so it will be 1.25. 5 over 4, 1.25. Yes, correct. Okay. So if CO2 is 1, then your oxygen gas, it will be 1.25. Okay. If your CO2 is 2, then it will be 2.5. Okay. If your oxygen gas is 4, if your CO2 gas is 4, then your oxygen gas, it will be 5. Okay, CO2, 4, oxygen gas, 5. So from here, using together with the initial hydrocarbon. Okay, so we need to compare with the CXHY as well, okay? So 10 centimeter cube, don't forget we have 10 centimeter cube here. Okay, so if over here, if all we compare with the 10 centimeter cube only, so everything divided by 10, so it will be 2.5, 1. So one mole of the hydrocarbon react with 2.5 mole of the oxygen gas will give you 2 mole of the carbon dioxide gas. So use these ratios to balance the equation. Okay, one mole of the CXHY, 2.5 you can write in the fractions. Okay, 5/2, then 2 mole of the CO2. Okay, deduce the value X, Y, and the Z in the equations form. Okay, then, okay, the X, right, CX become 2 CO2. So obviously, your X is 2, okay? Then your Y, we look at the hydrogen, right? So this one actually, we can use the X plus Y over 4 equal to 5/2. So in this case, your X is equal to 2. Then you can find out what is your Y. Then your Y should be equal to 2 as well. Okay, then at the end, the Z, you balance it. Okay. If your Y is 2, then your Z must be 1, okay, because we only look at the hydrogen. Can I use the ratios 2, 5, 4? Okay, let's say, okay, if here you use 2, 5, 4, so what is your X? X is also 2, right? Then what is your Y? Y, it will be X plus Y over 4. Now you get 5 here. So X equal to 2 plus Y divided by 4 equal to 5 minus. Y equal to 2, 5, 4. May I know how do you get Y equal to 2? because it oxygen. Yes, that has happened. Also here for. Oh, so you balance the Z first. Okay. Then H2O. So four. It should be four, right? Y should be four, right? If you take 250, because if your Z is 2 here, you have 2 multiplied by 2, right? So your Y should be 4. Or did I miss anything? But then each atom is 8. Okay, okay. 2, 2. X plus Y over 4. Minus 1, I get 3 over 4. Okay, I think your answer should be correct. 2, 2, 5, 4. So your answer will be 2 x y z should be 2, 2, 2. Okay, then if okay, then for my answer, okay, let me check it again. Whether correct or not. Okay, if I use 1, 2.5, 2, so oxygen's 5/2, 2.5. 2, so in this case, my Z should be half. Four, five, one. So Z must be 1. So in this case, the Z1, so H2, Y also must be 2. Okay, so I think both answers should be correct. Okay. So we have 2 answers here. If you reuse 1, 5/2, 2, then the x, y, z, it will be 2, 2, 1. If the ratio here you use 2, 5, 4, then your x, you get 2, y, you get 2. Z also you get 2. Okay, so 2 different answer. Okay, just now I think because just now throughout my explanation in this question, right, questions 19, I just now mentioned about we can use x plus y over 4 to find the y over here, right? Okay, this is special case because just now I tried to calculate, actually we cannot get it the correct answer. So because I believe that this is the CXHY in this case, right? they are not alkane most probably. Not alkane. So for the case they are not alkane, so there is some problems, okay, in solving this part. So for us, okay, next time if you have this kind of problems or questions, we try to look for, because in this case, right, your oxygen's already balanced for you. Okay, so oxygen gas balanced to you already. So actually we can find out what is the what is the Z value here. Okay, so first step here, the first step, we can find the X first. Find the X. Okay, because from 1 mole to 2 mole or 2 mole to 4 mole, the X value is always 2. Okay, the X value is always 2. Then the second step is you find the Z first. Okay, using the missing O. To balance the O first, okay? By balancing the oxygen. Then only we find the Y. Okay, by balancing the H. Okay, this is the detailed step, okay, in how to calculate the X, Y, Z. Okay, now we look at the last question, 20. Okay, write down the balanced chemical equations for the sodium carbonate plus the HCl. So acid plus carbonate, you will get 3 things. Okay, salt H2O and the CO2. Okay, then make sure it is balanced. So every species is in 1 mole except for the HCl, it is 2 mole, and also the salt and HCl, it is in 2 mole. Okay, number 2. Calculate the amount of the HCl present in the 35.8 centimeter cube of the solution. So they give you the volume. They also give you the concentration right here. Concentration 0.100 mole per dm cube of the HCl. So you have concentrations, you have volume, then definitely you can find out the number of mole. Okay, use your answer 1 and 2. So using the equation and also the number of mole of the HCl, calculate the number of mole of the sodium carbonate. Okay, sodium carbonate in 25 centimeter cube. Okay, you highlight this 25 centimeter cube. Okay, so this one is you doing the titration. Okay, so this 25 centimeter cube, it is in your conical flux. Okay, it is in your conical flux. Okay, then later on the next questions is asking you 250 centimeter cube. So you can see the volume is different here. Okay, so we come back the question, this question first. So question number 3. So based on the stoichiometry 1 to 2, so the number of mole for the sodium carbonate, it will be half of the number of mole of the HCl. So this will be your answer, 1.79 times 10 to the power of negative 3. Then number 4, okay, use your answers, part 3, to calculate the number of mole of the sodium carbonate in 250 centimeter cube. So now your volume is times 10 now, right? From 25 become 250, okay? So your volume multiplies by 10 So the concentration is still the same. Then the mole, it will be multiplied by 10 also. Okay, this one actually it is, let's say here, number of mole equal to mv over 1000, right? This is the formula. Okay, however, in this case, your concentration is constant. Okay, your concentration is constant. So from here, we can do a relationship whereby number of mole is directly proportional to the volume. So not when your volume is multiplied by 10 from 25 to become 250 centimeter cube. So your number of mole also multiplied by 10. Okay, so your final answer here, 0.0179 mole. Okay, multiply by 10. In number 5, hence calculate the mass for the sodium carbonate present in the crystal. Okay, this is the mole for the sodium carbonate. Okay, then we multiply with the relative formula mass. We get the mass of the carbonate, sodium carbonate. So it will be 1.897 gram. Okay, then use your calculation in part A. Okay, basically this one. So to determine the value of X, okay, in the sodium carbonate dot XH2O. So this is the hydrated salt. Okay, you have learned this in your chapter 1. This is hydrated salt. Okay, you can see the ionic compound then dot with the water molecule. So this is the hydrated salt. Okay, so from here, they assume that all the crystal, it is washing soda. Okay, hydrated washing soda is the hydrated sodium carbonate. So all the crystal here, we assume it is the sodium carbonate without any impurity. Okay, then, so however, at the part A, right, at the final answer here, we only calculate there is 1.897 gram of the sodium carbonate. Okay, however, the crystal, the mass of the crystal, it is 5.13 gram. So the mass difference here, it is the mass of the water. Okay, the mass difference between the mass of the crystal plus the mass of the pure sodium carbonate. Okay, the difference here, it is the mass of the H2O. So from here, we can get the mass of the H2O, then we can calculate the number of mole for the H2O. Okay, so it will be 0.18 mole. So we can use this mole to find out what is the X value. Okay, for this part, I show you in a clear picture. Okay, so now we are going to find out what is the X, right? Sodium carbonate dot XH2O. Okay, so if we using the method sodium carbonate with the H2O. So first thing, let's say we write down the mass. So the mass for the sodium carbonate, it will be 1.897, right? So for the water, it will be 3.233 gram. Okay, then the mole for the sodium carbonate, it will be 0.0179 mole. For the water, 0.18 mole. So for the simplest mole ratio, okay, we take 0.0179 divided by 0.0179. Here we get 1. Okay, then here we will get 10. So then we look back the formula here. it is one mole of the sodium carbonate with the x mole of the H2O, right? Then we come to the our answer. One mole of the sodium carbonate, it should be 10 mole of the H2O. So from here, we can conclude that the x is equal to 10. Okay, so we can just use this is the empirical formula, table, right? Mass, mole, simplest mole ratio to help us find out what is the X value, okay, in the hydrated salt of the sodium carbonate. Okay, Ken. So basically, we have done with the tutorial 2. Okay, so let us take a 5 minutes break. Okay, 5 minutes. Then later on, we are going to enter the new chapter. Okay, so this will be the chapter 3. Okay, chapter 3, right? What we are going to learn is bonding. Okay, in chapter 3, we are going to learn the bonding. Bonding separate, there is primary bonding and also secondary bonding. Okay, so for the primary bonding, we have, let's say the first one, ionic bonding, we will find in the ionic compound. Okay, then we have covalent bonding. Okay, further classified for the covalents, there are giant covalent bonding and simple covalent bonding. Okay, under simple covalent bonding, we have one sub bonding we call dative bond. Okay, then the third one, it will be the metallic bonding. Okay, metallic bonding only can find in the pure metal. So under primary, okay, what you are going to learn is these three big groups: ionic bonding, covalent bonding, metallic bonding. Okay, then comes to secondary bonding. Secondary bonding, there are mainly two. Okay, we can classify it into two. One is induced dipole-dipole forces. Okay, another one is permanent dipole-dipole forces. Okay, you may find these names familiar, okay, because you should learn in your secondary school. Then we have another name for the secondary bonding, a general name, okay, we call it intermolecular forces. Intermolecular forces, or we call it van der Waal forces. Okay. Then under permanent dipole-dipole forces, it can further classify one more bonding or one more forces. We call it hydrogen bonding. Hydrogen bonding, it may be something new for you, okay? Hydrogen bonding, then we are going to learn the special. What is special regarding the hydrogen bonding? Okay, then mainly this is the guideline or overview, okay, the mind map on what we are going to learn in the chapter 3. Of course, there are a lot of things else, okay, later on. Especially, okay, then I would say, right, for I think at least 70% our time, it will be spending on the covalent bonding and also secondary bonding, okay, all the secondary bonding. Ionic bonding and metallic bonding, the topics is considered quite short, okay, if we compare to the covalence and the secondary bonding, okay. So chapter one, you learn the metals, right? Nucleus, neutron, proton, electron. Then you learn some properties, okay? Example, atomic radius, and atomic radius, ionic radius, ionization energy, right? Ionization energy and so on. Chapter two, we go to the calculations, okay? Or in specific, mole concept, mass, volume, and the mass volume and the number of particles, right? Okay, how are they going to convert to mole, and how the mole convert back to the to these three, volume, mass, and also the number of particles. Then we also learn the number of mole of the solution. Okay, so these three. And the next topic, chapter number four, we are going to learn some gases theory. Okay, these four first chapter, right, are considered fundamental chapters. Okay, then only chapter five, we are going to move on the first big topic. Okay, physical chemistry. Okay, so now let us start the chapter three. Okay, chapter three. So first thing is we have to know why there is bonding, okay, or how is the bonding formed, okay? Why there is ionic bonding? Why there is covalent bonding? Why there is metallic bonding? Okay, and so on. So actually, all these things, it will go back to one point. We call it electronegativity. Okay. So what is electronegativity? Electronegativity, it is ability of an atom to attract the electrons to itself. Okay, means that if one atom, it can attract the electron towards itself easily, so it has high electronegativity. If one atom tends to release the electrons, then the atom has low electronegativity. So when I say release and accepting electron, so if we referring back to the periodic table, okay, let's say we have group 1, group 2, then we have group 16, group 17. Okay, so for the group 1, for the example, we have lithium, sodium, potassium, right? Group two, we have magnesium, calcium, barium. 16, we have, let's say, nitrogen, oxygen. Okay, Cl, 17, we have Cl, Br, I. So these group one and group two means at the left-hand side of your periodic table, they have low electronegativity. Okay, then at the to the right of the periodic table, right, except group 18. So usually we look at group 17, it will be our last group. Okay, don't look at group 18 because group 18 is inert, okay, inert gases. So 16 and group 17, they have high electronegativity. Okay, because group 1, group 2, they tend to form positive ions, right? Cations. Okay, they tend to release the electron. Okay, however, for group 16 and group 17, they tend to form negative ions or we call it anions. So they tend to attract the electron, right? So from this ability, okay, in terms of, then we look back to the periodic table, especially the most extreme, okay, the most left two, group one, group two, okay, these two have very low electronegativity. Then group 16, group 17, they have very high electronegativity. Okay, this one in your mind first. Keep it in your mind first. Then now, let us look at the difference. Okay, if you have two atoms have the same electronegativity, okay, then they have the same tendency to attract the bonding pair. For example, Cl, Cl. Okay, so the electron, they will stay at the middle. Okay, stay at the middle. Equally shared. Okay, equally shared. So Cl and Cl, they have the same tendency, right? They have the same electronegativity to attract the bonding pair of the electron. So Cl and Cl, they are known as, so they have what? They have the covalent bond. Okay, they have covalent bond. Okay, then now we look at the second example. Okay, if one of the atom, let's say atom B, is slightly more electronegative compared to the atom A. So atom B will attract the electron pair more. So you can see the electron pair is closer towards the atom B, right? Okay, rather than it stay at the middle. Okay, unlike the first example, the electron pair at the middle. Second example, the electron pair is moved or it is closer towards the B. Okay, so if this is the case, right, we have dipole. Okay, you can see this delta positive and delta negative. This one we call dipoles. Okay, so in this case, example HBr, in this case, it is still forming covalent bond. Okay, however, this covalent bond, it is known as polar covalent bond. Okay, the example one, it will be non-polar covalent bond. Okay, there are slightly different in terms of the naming. Okay, number four. If atom B is a lot more negative, electronegative compared to the atom A, so electron pair is totally dragged towards atom B. At the same time, atom A has lost control of the electron pair. So in this case, ions are formed. So you will have positive ions and negative ions. Okay, the ones lose, the atom that lose electron will form positive ions. The one accepting the electron, they will form an ion. Okay, so in this case, you will have A positive, B minus. So the bonding here, it will be ionic bonding. Okay, ionic bonding. Then we have a skills can help us to predict type of the bonding. Okay, so this skill, we call it Pauling skill. This skill is the most commonly used. Okay, so just now I say which group has group 16 and group 17, right? Okay, so these two groups, they are very electronegative. Okay, so the skills over here we use, okay, we can see that 4.0 is referring to the fluorine atom. So the most electronegative atom in the periodic table, it is fluorine. Okay, it is fluorine. Then we look at the group one. The most electropositive, it will be the francium and also scansium, okay, CS and also FR, 0.7. Okay, these two elements, they are the most electropositive. Okay, then how are we going to know? For example, H and Cl, whether they are covalent bond or ionic bond, or Na and also Cl, whether they are, when they mix together, they are going to form ionic bonds or covalent bonds. Okay, we have a table for us to refer. Okay, we can look at this table. This table, huh? So if the electronegativity difference is from 0 to 0 to 5, okay, this kind of the bonding, they are known as non-polar covalent. Okay, for example, Cl, Cl just now, okay, both have the same electronegativity, right? 3.5 minus 3.5, you get 0. Okay, okay, if you get polar covalent, okay, when do you get polar covalent? When the difference goes to 0.5 to 1.6. Okay, example. Example, let's say aluminium chloride. Okay. Aluminium chloride, the differences 3.0 minus 1.5, right? So the differences, it is 1.5 only. So 1.5 only. So if we refer back to the electronegativity here, so it is polar covalent compound, or that is polar covalent bonding. Okay, not ionic bonding. Eh? Then if you have 1.6 to 2, okay, it would be ionic if a metal and non-metal involved. Okay, if it is both are non-metals involved, then it will be polar covalent bond. Okay, if you have more than 2.0, the differences, it will be definitely ionic bonding. Okay, these tables can help you to predict the bonding. Okay, however, not every time accurate lah, okay, just to let you know, but in your syllabus, the question that come out should follow this table, okay, so don't worry. Okay, then example H and Cl, the differences 0.9, so it will be polar covalent, and HCl, so the differences more than 2, right, so straight away, ionic. Okay, Br and Br, the differences 0, so non-polar covalent. H and F, okay, H and F, the differences come to 1.9. However, H and F, these two are both are non-metal atoms, okay, so the final bonding, the bond, the final bonding form, it will be polar covalent. Okay. So from the tables or from the electronegativity, we can predict the bonding between the elements or between the atoms. Okay, then number 8. Okay, there are a few factors affecting the electronegativity. Okay, if you go through these factors, you will find that these three are the similar factors. Right, when you compare with your what's that, ionization energy, right, ionization energy. Okay, so let us go through these factors. So electronegativity increases as the nuclear charge increases. Okay, now let us let us back to the fundamental of the electronegativity first. So it would be the ability to pull the electron, right? Okay, so why nuclear charge increase the ability to pull the electron increase? Because when nuclear charge increase, what happen? Your proton number increase. When your proton number increase means you have extra protons to attract the electron, right? Okay, so when nuclear charge increase, electronegativity increase. However, this only applicable across the period. Okay, across the period means that you cannot compare different periods. Okay, you cannot compare different periods. That means that so if we back to the this table. Okay, let's say now we compare boron and also the fluorine. Okay, across the period, so fluorine has more proton number, right? So it has greater electronegativity compared to the boron. However, you cannot compare different period. If you compare, let's say you compare boron and also aluminium. Okay, aluminium, it has more nuclear charge, right? Okay, because more proton number. However, the electronegativity over here, it is decreases, okay, due to another factors. Okay, so nuclear charge only compare across the period. Different period, we cannot compare using the nuclear charge, okay? Okay, second one, it will be the atomic radius. So when going down the group, okay, different period, going down the group, electronegativity decreases because the radius increases. When radius increases, electrons are less likely to be attracted strongly. Okay, when distance far, the attraction forces is weakened. Okay, become weakened. So it causes the electronegativity decrease the ability to attract the electron. Okay, then C, shielded by the inner shell. Okay. So fluorine has 9 protons, chlorine has 17 protons, okay. 1s, 1s, 2s, 2p. Okay, so in terms of the this one you can refer back in when we say shielded, okay, shielded is shielded effect, okay, shielded by what? By the inner shell, by the inner electrons, okay? So we have learned the orbitals, remember orbitals? Okay, fluorine only is, because it will be at the 1s, 1s. 1s2, 2s2, 2p7, right? Okay, in HF, the inner shells, only 1s, right? However, for the Cl, the inner shell, there is 1s, 2s, 2p. So we can see that HF and also Cl, okay, F and also Cl, if you refer back to the table just now, the electronegativity decreases, right? Okay, the reason why, that is another fact. The reason why is because the number of the inner shell increases. Okay, this one you can talk about the atomic radius, okay? Because when going down the groups, there are two factors affecting. One is the radius, another one is the shielding effect. Okay, so total three factors. First one, nuclear charge. This one we only compare across the period. Atomic radius and also the shielding effect, we compare when going down the groups. Okay, so three factors affecting the electronegativity. Okay, then the next one, it will be the ionic bonding already. Okay, I think this for this part, we will continue next week. Is it okay? So today, basically, we're done with the chapter 2. Okay, and we also covered the introduction for the chapter 3 already. So before I end the class, anything you want to ask? Okay, for your, you should know that there is another intake right after you, so they will join in the May, in May. Okay, so my target with your class in January class, so I plan to finish the chapter 3. Okay, then for the May intake, basically I will repeat the same thing. However, the class, right, they should take around 2 weeks to cover 4 months what you have learned. Okay, they take 2 or 3 weeks, less than 1 month. Yeah, less than 1 month. Then they cover everything you have learned from chapter 1 to chapter 3, then only we combine. Okay, so for the if you want to join later on, means we learn it again from the chapter 1 to chapter 3. If you want to join, it is good. Okay, if you want, but it is not compulsory as you have learned it already. Okay, just to let you know, okay, in case you think that you are not good in certain topics, then you can come to the class, okay, when combining, when comes to May intake. Okay, so see you in the next week. Okay, bye bye.